ऑफ PES IEEE BBD IITM लखनऊ। इट्स माई प्राउड प्रिविलेज टूडे टू वेलकम यू ऑल इन दिस एक्सपर्ट लेक्चर ऑर्गेनाइज बाई IEEE BBD IITM स्टूडेंट ब्रांच इन कोलेबरेशन विद IEEE BBD IITM सिग्नल प्रोसेसिंग सोसाइटी ऑन द टॉपिक रिसर्च पेपर प्रोजेक्ट प्रपोजल सबमिशन एंड पेपर राइटिंग। थैंक यू फॉर ज्वाइनिंग अस टूडे। Participants are requested to keep their microphones and video off during the program. Our branch has been organizing various events on virtual platforms and competition on various topics, including webinar on advanced signal processing technique, IEEE student member development program, and many more. Recently, our student branch has been awarded as the best student branch by IEEE Uttar Pradesh section. On behalf of IEEE BBD IITM student branch, I extend a warm thank you to everyone who has been supporting us and attending the program. Here is a short glimpses of various events organized by our branch from time to time. Most humbly, now I would like to invite Dr. Khadim Mohin Siddiqui for the welcome address.
Thank you, Prince. Am I audible, Prince? Prince, am I audible?
Yes, sir, you are completely audible.
Yes.
Yes, sir, sure.
Okay, thank you, Shrey. A very good morning to everyone. It's my proud privilege to give welcome address on behalf of entire fraternity of Babu Banarsidas Institute of Technology and Management, BBD IITM Lucknow, especially on behalf of our Honorable Chairperson, BBD Guru, Ma'am Mrs. Alka Das, Honorable President, BBD Guru, Sir Mr. Viras Sagar Das, Honorable Director, BBD IITM, Sir Professor Dr. Bhavesh Kumar Chauhan, respected branch counselor and HOD, EE and EEEE Professor Rafiq Ahmed, and Professor Kanika Lama Ma'am, Advisor, WI, BBD IITM, Lucknow. Before thanks to Honorable Speaker, I would like to share with you a quote that research is seeing what everybody else has seen and thinking what nobody else thought. So now, with sincere thanks and gratitude, I would like to welcome our Honorable Chief Guest come Speaker, Dr. Mini Rajiv, IEEE Senior Member, Associate Professor, Agnel Charities, Francis Rodriguez Institute of Technology, Vashi Navy, Mumbai, who has accepted our invitation gladly. Honorable Ma'am, your gracious presence as a speaker in this webinar under topic Basic of Research, Paper Writing and Project Proposal Submission. Indeed, we hope this session will achieve its learning outcome in the effective way. Especially, I want to mention about you, ma'am. You have won so many glorious awards in the research side and as well teaching also. And also you have published a lot of research papers in various IEEE transactions and conferences. So your active involvement as a reviewer is also commendable. Hope we and our participants will be so much benefited in this skill building session. Further, I would like to thank to all IEEE office bearers such as Shrey Khanna, Chair IEEE BBD IITM Student Branch, Ms. Shambhavi, Chairperson IEEE BBD IITM Signal Processing Chapter, and all student members for organizing the event. Again, thank you so much, ma'am, for joining us. Anchor, now it is over to you, please. Hello.
Thank you so much, sir, for your motivational word. Now, with a great pleasure, I would like to introduce our speaker, Dr. Mini Rajiv. Dr. Mini Rajiv is presently working as an associate professor in the Department of Electrical Engineering at FRC Rodriguez Institute of Technology, Vashi Navi Mumbai. Dr. Mini has total 28 years of working experiences in teaching as well as in industrial and research work. She received her BTech degree from the University of Kerala and her MTech and PhD in Power Electronics and Power System from IIT Bombay. Besides being a bright student, Dr. Mini has also been an achiever throughout. She received a performance award for work excellence from SSB Industries Limited, Bangalore. Her project Solar Power Street Light won the second prize in the best project category in KIF 2009. Dr. Mini has received Best Paper of the Conference Award from IEEE International Conference CQ 2017 Bangalore December 2017 and also the award Best Faculty of the Year. Specify Innovation Manifest in Prototype Patent etc. at CSI Tech Next India 2018. She won the third Best Paper Award for the paper titled A Study of Replacing CFL by LED Light for solar powered street light in standalone system in NCNTE 2010. Dr. Mini also got certified for excellence in 10 days ISTE workshop on solar photovoltaic fundamentals, technology and applications conducted by IIT Bombay in December 2011. Dr. Mini's research interests include power converter topologies, solar photovoltaic system, standalone and grid connected converter control, etc. Today, it's a great honor for us to interact with such an achiever. So now I humbly request Dr. Mini Rajiv to come forward for the expert talk. Over to you, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you for that nice introduction. Without any delay, I will start the seminar. I'll share the screen now. Are you able to see my screen?
Yes, ma'am, it's visible.
Yeah. So, good morning to you all once again. So, as mentioned by Prince and Professor Kadim Moin Siddiqui, I will be talking about three parts, or I'll be having three parts in my presentation: basics of research, paper writing, and project proposal submission. I'll not be going in depth, but I'll give a flavor of all the three topics in my talk. So this is the content layout. So I'll be talking about basics of research, then steps of engineering research, the art of paper writing, plagiarism, why we should avoid plagiarism. Then what are the important points that needs to be considered while submitting a project proposal. So what is research? So the same sentence I've seen you all writing in your registration form also. I'll come to it. Before that, all of us do some kind of research, I should say. The research, it can be a formal research or an informal research. So all of us do informal research. When you want to buy something, let us say online, if you want to buy something, definitely we search for reviews. Okay, which product to buy and what are the reviews of that, how many people have bought it, we do. And also if you want to visit some places, like if you want to visit Manali or visit Darjeeling, some example I'm telling. So we search for which is a good hotel to stay, what are the things to see there, all that we do. So these are all part of informal research. So today I am talking about formal research. So formal research is a search for knowledge. It's a search for knowledge. Now, as rightly pointed out by Mr. Albert St. Gheorghe, it is the research. Research is to see what everybody else has seen and to think what nobody else has thought. And this reminds me of my PhD days. See, when I was doing a PhD, when I joined for PhD, I have joined under quality improvement program. So we had to do some teaching assistantship. So when I was doing that, my mentor, whom we were associating for this teaching assistantship in first year, sir used to tell us that as a researcher, you should find out what others have not done. So I used to think at that time, how I will find out what others have not done. I can find out what others have done. I used to think at that time. So over the years, I found out that that is what we should find out to proceed in our research. We should find out what others have not done, or we should find out the gap in the research, what is already done, what others missed to point out. That is what we should find in research. Now coming, the first and important thing is to find out how to, or to do, how to select, or how to find out a topic for research. You can say that that is an obstacle in research. So first of all, it depends on our area of interest. And that should be an active area where a lot of research is going on. Then only you can make an impact on that research. Then you can also see conference call for papers. You must have seen conference call for papers. They give a list of topics or tracks for the conference. So that you can do a detailed study on those topics, whether you are finding interest in some of the topics mentioned there. Then reputed journal or conference papers. Even though you are not a member, like for IEEE, even though we are not a member of IEEE, we can see the abstract of papers, journal papers, as well as conference papers. So that is there for all other publishers as well. So from there also, we can read and see what people have done, whether we are interested in that topic. The next is discussion with the expert in the field. It could be a professor, it could be a senior researchers, or it could be an industry person who is doing in the similar area, a broader area. And also you can search topics in other universities, research topics, what are other universities, what research topics they are giving to their research scholars. It can be a university abroad, it can be an Indian universities. So these are the ways which came to my mind, and when I did a literature survey, which got how to select a topic for research. Now coming to 7 steps of engineering research. The first question, or the first step, is to ask questions. Now, why do we need to ask questions? To identify the need for research. And next step is to search literature to see what is already done. Anyway, I'm talking about in detail in the subsequent slides. The third step is to formulate. You have to do a problem statement and a hypothesis. Now, what is hypothesis? It is there in my slides. So after having a problem statement and an hypothesis, you have to develop ideas. Means, what are the possible solutions for the problem stated? The next step is to select a promising solution. You may think about different solutions. So in that, what is the optimum solution, or what is the best solution? What is the promising solution? You have to choose. Then test the solution, whether your hypothesis is correct. Otherwise, you need to modify it. And then conclude the research. So these are the 7 steps of engineering research. Now we will discuss one by one. The first step was to ask questions to identify the need. So they say that you should be curious like a journalist, or ask questions like a journalist. What is that? Where it happened? Why it happened? How it is? All these questions you can ask like a journalist. And why are we asking questions? to identify the need to research in that topic. Now, next step is to search literature. Now, why do we search literature? To provide knowledge on the selected topic. Okay, you get more knowledge on what topic you have selected. Then identify the gaps in the research in the selected topic. What are the gaps? What people missed to identify? Then understand the conflicts in the previous related studies. When you search literature, you find that some theories or some experiments, so one author is specifying, other author may say it is wrong due to this reason. So there you can find some conflicts in the understanding of studies. So to understand that conflicts. The next, explanation of work by other authors. Means you will know how well to explain the work by reading other people's work, how they have presented, how well they have organized. So seeing that, we can explain our work in a better way. Then avoid making mistake. Same mistake which previous researchers have done, not to repeat that. Then identify the need for additional research. So that will justify our research. The next is formulating the research problem. So first thing is the problem statement. Problem statement should be a clear and brief description of problems that needs to be addressed during research. So as a researcher, we should understand what is the problem. We should clearly understand what is the problem. So that is why I have shown a doctor's photo here. So in order to diagnose or proper diagnosis, doctor should know what are the problems or should understand what are the problems faced by his patient. So like that, a researcher should know what is the problem, exact problem to be addressed during the research. Now, once you have the problem statement, you can make an hypothesis. Now, what is that hypothesis? We can say that hypothesis is a tentative or an intelligent guess of the solution to the problem. And the solution it will be in such a way that it can be tested. It is an intelligent guess to the solution. I am giving an example for that. Intelligent guess of the solution to the problem which you have stated. And that we will have to test it, means that has to be tested. So I'm giving an example of an engineering research. I'm giving from an electrical engineering point of view because I'm basically from electrical engineering background. So let us say that the selected topic is extraction of energy from solar photovoltaic modules using an inverter. Okay, now nowadays renewable energy, the generation from energy from renewable sources is an upcoming field. So extraction of energy from solar photovoltaic modules using an inverter. Inverter is nothing but a DC to AC converter. So that is the topic selected. Now coming to the problem statement. So problem statement can be current. So there are different types of inverters. You have voltage source inverters, you have current source inverters. Now current source inverter is not used much in extracting energy from solar photovoltaic systems, even though it has high gain. So it has high gain. So suppose the inverter has high gain, you can reduce the number of PV panels required. But still, current source inverters are not used much. That is my problem statement. Now my hypothesis could be, there is a high input inductor used in current source inverter, which is not there in other inverters, like voltage source inverters, and which will add to the size, cost, and performance of the system. Okay, so my intelligent guess or solution could be, if I reduce the value of inductor, that will improve the usage of CSI. So it is an if-then statement. Hypothesis is an if-then statement. If I do this, this will happen. That is an intelligent guess. Or you can call it as a hypothesis. The next step is to develop ideas or solutions on how to reduce the input inductor in current source inverter. There may be n number of solutions already existing. So what is missing in that? What are the problems with that? So how my idea is different from that? What is the advantage of my idea? Or how can I put forth one idea or ideas which are different from others? So develop ideas or solutions and choose the best one. Like I said, the next step is to choose the promising solution. then test the selected idea or solution. After that, we can improve it. If there is any issue in the test results, we can improve it. Then we will conclude. So this is an excellent example of engineering research, which I've already explained that there are 7 steps of research. Now coming to qualities of a good researcher. This I am not reading, you can read yourself. This is from the source, Ludeme. You can see that he has given explanation for each letter of researcher. Okay, so I liked all the points. This is absolutely correct. All these points are absolutely correct for you to become a good researcher. So that's it about how basics of research. Now, how to publish the research work? Coming to the art of paper writing. So this is the structure of a technical paper. First, you will have a title of the paper. Again, I'm explaining one by one in the subsequent slides. So you will have a title of the paper, then names of the authors. Authors' names are written in the order how they have contributed to the paper. Whoever is having or whoever has contributed the maximum, that person will be the first author. And so in the order of contribution, generally we write the names of authors. Then we will have an abstract, introduction, literature review, then work done, what is the work done, what is the methodology used, results and discussion about the results, conclusion, and then at the end we will have references. I'm explaining one by one. Now sometimes an acknowledgement is inserted between conclusion and references as shown here. Now why do we need an acknowledgement? If you have a funding for your project, you can write the names of those funding agencies. I acknowledge this funding agency for providing us a financial support for doing this work. Next, persons who assisted in the work were not involved in paper writing. So those persons, you can thank them. You can acknowledge what they have done for you. And also, you can provide a short list of keywords after abstract. Now, how this will help? This will help in other researchers when they are searching for their related work. Your paper will appear, or your paper they will get if it is a related work. So next is title of the paper. We need to think of an informative but catchy title. So title should predict the content of the research paper. So by reading the title, a person or reader should understand what is the content of that research paper. So generally 5 to 15 words are used for a title. And these words that will be creating a positive impression and that will attract the readers. So you can spend some time in preparing or in finalizing the title of the paper. You can also think of multiple titles and choose the best one that conveys the uniqueness. See, an example I'm giving, again, I'm giving the example of my paper only. Analysis and control of a novel transformerless microinverter for photovoltaic grid interface. So here, it is clear by reading the title, it is clear that it is a new transformerless inverter. And it is used for photovoltaic grid interface. And what I'm doing in that, analysis and control of the inverter. So that is clear from this title. So somebody who is doing an analysis of an inverter can search, paper will be useful for them. Similarly, someone who is working on a micro inverter or somebody who is working for a photovoltaic grid interface, for all these people, they can read or they can go through this paper or they'll be interested in going through the papers, reading the title. So that is why I said you have to think of an informative but a catchy title. Coming to abstract. Abstract generally is a single paragraph. It's a single paragraph of approximately 150 to 200 words. But it depends on the publisher. I'm just telling in based on IEEE. But it depends on the publisher. Different publisher has different limitation for words. And the abstract should be clear and concise. And then it should explain purpose of work, okay, then brief description of the work in brief, and then information, a general information about the results obtained. You need not write what are the results obtained in detail. A general information about the results obtained. An example of an abstract I'm showing here, you can see first I have written what is the purpose of my work. I have written, in order to face the challenges due to large scale integration of PV inverters on the distribution side, inverters are expected to provide certain ancillary services, and I have explained what are these ancillary services. So that is the purpose of my work, okay. And then brief description of the work, what did I do. I have written, transformerless inverter can provide the desired ancillary services more efficiently and at a lesser cost. Okay, so that will be different from others. I'm explaining that my work is different from others. And then similarly, information about the results obtained. I have given here experimental results obtained from a 200 watt laboratory prototype illustrate how additional controlled features can be integrated. That means I have done an experimental study on a 200 watt wattage laboratory prototype, and I presented the results in this. So this is the abstract, what you need to be, or you need to take care while writing an abstract. So next is introduction. Basically, there are four paragraphs in the introduction. The first one is importance of the work. Why others should read your work, or why others should read your paper. That should come in the first paragraph. The next paragraph, background of the work. What is the problem with the existing solutions? The third paragraph could be the purpose of the present work. Why the present study is needed? You have already explained in the previous paragraph what is the problem with the existing solutions. So you can work upon that and write the purpose of present work. Why the present study is needed. Then can mention how the remaining part of paper is organized. It will be good, or it will be better to explain what are the contents of the remaining sections of the paper. So a person who is reading the abstract and introduction will understand what is the paper all about, or what is the work, what, how they have done, what all they have presented. A brief idea of all this they will get while reading the paper, abstract and introduction. So generally we mention section 2 contains design, section 3 contains experimental results, and section 4 like that. So that's all about the introduction. Then coming to literature review, I already mentioned in the previously why do we need literature review. So it also gives credits, as far as a paper is concerned, it gives credits to those who have laid the groundwork of the selected topic. Okay, original paper, basically you should write about the original paper where your work is, or the beginning of the work is mentioned, not the work which is which somebody has done based on the original work. So it is better always to include the original paper in the literature review. And evaluate past research to avoid duplication. Okay, an extensive research is required, or literature survey is required, so that you will not repeat what others have done. And also to know the methodologies used in the study by other authors. Then only you can understand the gaps, to find the gap so that your work will make a significant contribution in the literature. So you should know what are the gaps in the previous research, or in the previous methodologies done or carried out by other authors. So next comes the main body. This is very important, like the heart of a system. We can say it is the heart of the paper. So this can have various subsections. So it will contain the brief description of how the work was carried out. Any basic concept you have, based on some concept you have started the work. So that what is that concept? Brief description of that. Then this will also have design, simulation, and experimental details. It will contain results and discussion. Always when you are mentioning about the results, you should discuss how the results are correct. You should always convince the readers, why do you think the results are correct? Not just showing the results. This is the result we obtained. That is not a good paper. You should always say, what are the good result, or why the result is good, or why do you say the results are, or results met your expectations. Okay, so next is tables, graphs and diagrams to explain the result. It is said that we remember 10% of what we read and 30% of what we see. So it is always good, or as far as possible, you explain the results in terms of tables, graphs and diagrams. So better to give a comparison with other competing solutions. Like suppose I have measured the harmonic distortion in a current waveform. Again, I'm telling electrical examples because I am from that background. Okay, so suppose we are measuring a technical or efficiency in general, I'll tell, talk about efficiency. So when I'm saying that I got 95% efficiency, I can always compare with others who have done the similar work. What is the efficiency they got? Okay, their efficiency is this much, but I got 2% more. So better to give a comparison with other competing solutions. So next is the conclusion of the paper. You need to elaborate on the impacts of the method presented. Conclusion is not a repetition of the abstract. Okay, so in conclusion, you need to elaborate on the impacts of the method presented. What are the impacts of the method that you have done? And any significant findings you have. Not the results. Results you already explained that I got this result, that you already done in the main body. So any significant findings which is very innovative, if you have, that you can mention in conclusion. Then you can state the limitations of your solution. So this is very good so that future researchers can take over the work or continue the work. So directions, that's what I've written, directions for future research in the field. Limitations of your solution and directions for future research in the field. Coming to references, references should be cited in the numerical order according to their order of appearance in the text. Okay, see, suppose you are referring some 10 references. Reference 1 should be mentioned in the text first, then reference 2, then reference 3. In that order, that's what I meant while writing this, should be cited in the numerical order according to their order of appearance in the text. That is easy for a viewer or a reader to understand which one you have referred for what. Otherwise also, the first reference should be the one which is the basic paper, and that you will be referring first. So obviously that will come first in the paper. So next is, you can cite journal or conference papers, textbooks, web address, technical reports, manuals, etc. can be cited. And how it should be cited, that is given in the template given by the publisher. Even IEEE has that. If you go to IEEE.org, you will get the template, LaTeX format, Word format, all you will get. Do not cite references in the abstract. In the abstract, generally, we don't cite any reference. Abstract is something which a person reads first in a paper. So that you should only summarize the work you have done. So why do you need appendix? So generally, some papers we have seen, they will include appendix. So this is a supplementary material to provide better understanding of the paper. Okay, it could be lengthy program codes which cannot be included in the paper. It will affect the flow of the paper while reading. You should always remember the audience, or you should always remember the reader. When a reader is reading the paper, there should be a flow for the paper. So that is why some authors prefer to put the lengthy program codes in the appendix. or it can be a mathematical background of a concept. Similarly, some proofs or sample calculations. There are many. I am only mentioning few of them. Some can explain an equipment if your research is about an equipment. It depends on the topic what you are writing about. So this is a summary of how it is or how to write different sections of the paper. This is from the source, Engineering Research Methodology by Krishnan Nallapirumal. So what did I do in a nutshell? That is what you are writing in the abstract. And what is the problem you are explaining in the introduction? How did I solve the problem? That is what you're explaining in the materials and methods, which I have explained it as a main body. Then what did I find out? That you are explaining in results section, which will be there as a, you can have as a subsection of the main body or as a separate section. It depends on the how much results you have got or how much you have to explain about the results. Now, what does it mean? That is what discussion part is. The results, what does it mean? Who helped me out? This is the acknowledgement. That is an optional. That is why I had not put it in the steps. Or when I showed that structure, I had not put it in that order. I put extra or additional information I have given. Similarly, whose work did I refer to, which is very important, literature cited or references. Then extra information in appendix. That's what I said. That is also optional. Okay. So this summarizes the different sections of a paper and why are we doing this. So next important part is the plagiarism. So what is plagiarism? Using ideas and words of other authors without giving credit. That is happening a lot in while writing paper. We can see that without giving credit, and the authors can take you to court for that. It can be a case against you if they wish to. So this has to be taken very seriously. Using ideas and words of others without giving credit. Copying from sources and writing as if you wrote it yourself. That is also plagiarism. Then using a source and not mentioning it correctly. See, when you're mentioning a source, a reader who reads the paper will search for that source. Okay? Who wants to know more about it will search for a source. That is the basic idea of giving the sources. So using a source and not mentioning it correctly, that is also plagiarism. Then copying a diagram, image, graph or photo without referencing the source. See, there are many plagiarism softwares available which can detect how much you have copied from other papers or other reports or thesis, which is there online. There are Turnitin, there IEEE also has IEEE CrossCheck. So these are all plagiarism checking softwares. Now the one of the main drawback of this softwares is they don't check exactly for the images which you are giving. So that is why it is seen in papers that people copy images and diagrams without mentioning the source, which is totally wrong. So whenever you are copying a diagram, you can do that, but you give credit to the source or credit to the person who did it. Copying a diagram, image, graph or photo without referencing the source. So like for example, I have given this, you can write, see this, I have given the picture source. So like that, you should give credit to the source. Somebody who is searching this source will see this diagram. So you have to give credit to the source. So how to avoid plagiarism? Now, if you're borrowing other authors' words, you can always cite your author and use quotation marks. So and so said this. Professor Lee or Minnie said this. Like that, you can write. And as according to Minnie, this is the thing which she has said. You can write in quotation marks. Similarly, paraphrasing. Paraphrasing is expressing the same thing or same idea using different words. That also should be avoided. Or if you are doing that, no, it is not that should be avoided. You can do that provided you cite your author. then you need not give any quotation marks because you are not using the same words of the author. You are writing in your own sentences, but you should cite your other author because it is the idea of the other author. So you should cite your author. Okay, so that is the difference between these two. If you are borrowing others' words, same words, then you should cite your author and use quotation marks. If you are paraphrasing, that means you are changing the wordings, then you need to cite your author. No need of quotation marks. Now, if you are using our own ideas and words, no citation and no quotation marks. So that way, you can avoid plagiarism. So, do's and don'ts of paper writing. Now, first one is use active voice as much as possible. So, it is better to say Minnie did this experiment instead of saying the experiment was performed by Minnie. That is passive voice. So, use active voice as much as possible. Now, that will reduce the number of words used and more understandable by the reader. And more simple, I should say. And better to use, or you can use past tense, because you are expressing or you are writing a paper based on the work which you have already completed. So use past tense while writing the paper. Now next is short sentences are easier to grasp than long ones. So generally it is said that you should be able to read one sentence loudly without taking a breath. Of course, you should not take a deep breath before that. So it is said that you should be able to read that sentence without taking a breath. That long only that sentence should be. Okay. So some researcher has said that it should be less than 34 words. Then we say that the sentence is good. So always try to use short sentences and convey the things. Then cite recent papers in the area of the work. Always a researcher or when you review a paper, one of the questions as a reviewer which we get for judging is, have they cited recent papers in the area of the work? So it is very important to cite recent papers in the area of the work. You are making sure that the work is going on in recent times also. So that shows the importance of the work. Then check for grammatical errors and spelling mistakes. There are softwares available for that. Spelling mistake, even Word or this one can do. So check for grammatical errors and spelling mistakes. That is also equally important. Even though technically the content is very good, if there are grammatical errors and spelling mistakes, it is not considered as a good paper. And the last but very important thing, do not plagiarize and do not fabricate the results. So write to impress and not to write to express and not to impress. Now, why am I saying this? Many try to impress by using some words which most of us have not seen. They will find out some words from dictionary and they use it. Okay, so that is for impressing. That is not won't impress actually. So that's why I said write to impress and not to write to express, not to impress. So that's all about the art of paper writing. Next, how to write a project proposal. So I'm concentrating more on the funded projects. There is research proposal also, more or less the same, but my concentration is on project proposal. So basically, three main questions needs to be answered while submitting a project proposal. So the first question could be, what project will you undertake? The second question, why do you want to do that? Okay. And the third question, how are you going to do this? So these three questions, if you're answering, that will be a good project proposal. So you have already mentioned what is the project you are undertaking and why am I doing this project? What is the reason? Then how I am going to do it, whether it is an experimental study, whether it is a simulation study, or it's a theoretical study, or it is a survey. So all this we will come to know from these three questions. Now coming to assessment of research proposal, and the criteria specified by them. Now I'm just discussing some common criteria. All are not there, but some common criteria I'm discussing here. So the first one, does the proposal adhere to the rules and guidelines? The first and foremost thing that a reviewer or a judge or who is judging the research proposal will see, does the proposal adhere to funding agency? Then does the proposal address an important research problem? Okay, so how well you have defined the research problem, that is very important. Now, will it add value to existing knowledge? Okay, so will it provide an advancement in the existing knowledge? Then only it is worth researching. So is the funding necessary to solve the problem? Or could it be solved with the normal resources of a good laboratory? So that should be evident from your project proposal. Why do you need a funding? Next is, does the proposal explain clearly what work will be done? Then does it explain what results are expected? You cannot present the results because you are going to do it. So, but you can say that this is what I'm expecting the results and how they will be evaluated. Okay. So like I will say that I will measure the efficiency of the product, or if suppose I'm doing some experiments on induction heating. So I will say that I will make that that experimental setup, or I will make a prototype, test it in the laboratory. So I expect that the heating of the material, it should be this much, or this much, this temperature I'm expecting. So you can measure using sensors. So that is how I'm evaluating that. Or if you're generating from a renewable energy source and using a converter to convert it to AC output, then what is the harmonic distortion at the output? And how will you evaluate that? I may be using a power analyzer to find out. Or if I'm using some mathematical methods, Fourier series, I'll be using fast Fourier series to do that. So all this you will have to explain. So that should be there in the proposal. Then is there evidence that the proposers know about the work that others have done on the problem? That is basically the literature survey. So one section should be literature survey in the project proposal, where you will mention what are the or what is the work done by others and what is the problem in that. Basically the gaps. So all these are related actually. Paper writing, there also you need to find that to select a topic or to do some research. So literature survey is very important. That is what you are understanding from this. Okay, so is there evidence that proposers know about the work that others have done on the problem? Then only you can find out what is a gap in the research. The next important thing is, do the proposers have a good track record, both of doing good research and of publishing it? Dissemination, that is very important. Publishing the results or presenting the results in front of other audience. Okay, so how do we know that, or how the reviewers know that? Using our biodata or biodata of the principal investigator, which we call us. So this criteria basically I have taken from the source. I have mentioned it and in references also. So this is the general structure of a project proposal. As you can see here, there will be a title of the project, project summary, like the abstract of the paper, then introduction, and that we have already discussed, literature review, which is very important. Then research plan, it should have a research plan. Okay, so what will be you doing? You will be doing a literature survey, and you will be doing an experimental study, and how long you will take to do that. So you should have a research plan. Simulation, if you are doing a simulation study, so how long you will take to do the simulation study. So like that, you should have a research plan in the proposal. then expected outcome. Again, results you cannot mention because you have not done it. You are going to do it. So, but what is the outcome or what is your expectation that you can mention? Then budget. This is very important. Budget with brief justification. Okay, generally the budget consists of equipment. You can purchase some equipment if it is that related project, or some software if it is a software related project. Then you can have consumables, then traveling, if you require traveling, or for presentation of the results, or means publishing, some funding agency give money for that also, to go and publish the paper, present the papers. So then some contingency, or for some grant for unexpected budget or expenses. So all that are involved in the budget. And when you're proposing the budget, you should propose with a brief justification. Why do you want that money? Or suppose you are explaining that you need an equipment. Why do you want that equipment? Let us say that we are mentioning that we need a digital storage oscilloscope, isolated digital storage oscilloscope. So you can explain that I want to see the results or the waveforms in the DSO. So isolated one is needed because I will not face any grounding issue. So like that you can explain. Then research facilities, that all the funding agencies will expect that you should have some research facilities in your institution so that you can add on. So research facilities, that will have to mention. Then references, that we have already mentioned, discussed about references. So a good project proposal will have an important research idea, a good grasp of relevant, this is in short I am telling, good grasp of relevant literature and issues, and a sound methodology. Okay, if you want to summarize, then you should also position important points strategically that will have a good impact on the judgment. Okay, positioning important points strategically that will have a good judgment, means good impact on the judgment. So coming to the curriculum vitae, basically most of the funding agencies specify that one page of the biodata or biography, one page. They will limit it to one page. So you cannot have pages and pages of biodata. So then you should think about what is the important points that you should put in the biodata. So basically we can put name and the contact information, then education, employment record, professional accomplishments, awards, honors, okay, whatever we have got, and publications and patents. So that will give an indication that how good the researcher is in terms of publications, in terms of accomplishments, academics, okay, and what is the professional experience, whether they are experienced to do the project. So this is what I referred for writing or making this presentation. Okay. So thank you. That's all about my presentation. So if you have any doubts, you can please ask.
Dear students and participants, if you have any question and you want to ask, then you are invited. Please open your mic and you can raise the question.
Good morning, ma'am.
Yeah.
Firstly, I would like to thank you for explaining very well in manner. There is one question in my mind. Ma'am, during the project making, there is a percentage of women's participation is only 20 to 30%. So how we can increase these percentages?
What is that? What is that? Attendees can ask. What is that? Can you tell me once again?
Ma'am, during any project participation, as we can see worldwide, there is a percentage of women participation is only 20 to 30%.
Women participation, so you are telling?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, okay.
So how we can increase these percentages?
How we can increase, you're asking?
Okay. Yes, ma'am. Like how we can motivate them to participate?
More. Okay, fine. That's a good question, actually. I'm happy to hear it. Okay. See, what you can do, there are many people are doing that. You can have a separate prize or separate this one for women. That is one thing. Okay, separate contest for women. And another thing, you can insist that the publication should contain one woman author. Okay, that many people do that. Many people do that for, and there are conferences where they say that at least one woman author should be there in the paper. So that way you can improve the participation of women so that others also will encourage women to participate in that or contribute in the paper so that you can write their name as one of the authors.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am, for this wonderful, knowledgeable session on paper and proposal writing. Now, I request the participants to kindly put down their questions, if any, related to the topic discussed. You can either use your chat box or your microphones for the purpose.
Can I ask the question?
Yes, yes, sure.
Okay. Good afternoon, ma'am. This is Yash from Father Agnel Vashi.
Yes.
So I had a doubt while selecting a research topic. The first thing what comes in my mind is that scalability and whether that particular topic would be beneficial for masses.
Yeah.
So whenever I try to, you know, go into stuff which is applicable for more of the masses, it tends to be less of on a technical side. And requires more of market analysis and all. Being in a engineering institute limits my exposure to people having a greater market analysis. So what would you suggest one should do?
Yeah. What I feel is now there is an equal division, I feel, between the researchers based on market analysis and all. And technical research. There are n number of topics available for doing a technical research. I can say about electrical background, I can say that there are topics which are coming up in the area of electric vehicles, okay, which we can contribute. And one of the major problem that we face now is the storage, isn't it? So there are many renewable sources coming up, and there are there is a problem of energy storage. So in energy storage, if you can do something, or like solar photovoltaic cells to improve the efficiency, if you can do something, that all will help all of us, like masses you are telling, no? That will help all of us. It's not that not only market, you need to do a detailed study of various topics on what research is going on. That's what I said. In the beginning, no, one of the slides I showed that what are the methods to select a research topic. So it could be you can search in other universities what all research is going on in your area of interest. Then you can search for call for papers. So definitely you will get different ideas. It's not that only market analysis related tech work is there. Okay, so you need to do a thorough study. First of all, you have to choose an area of interest. Because whatever method you choose, ultimately, you should have an interest in what you are doing. Then only you can come out with good results. You should love what you are doing. Okay, you cannot, somebody cannot force you. So in your area of interest, broader area, you can search more and then find out a topic where it will help the mass. That's what I feel.
Ma'am, since like giving an example of autonomous vehicle, it's a very hot topic right now, which is being, you know, researched upon extensively. So there are lots amount of publications, patents, and research going on currently. So how much time according to you should be contributed for this literature survey based upon which we can build our research?
Generally, when we give a research plan, we give 1 or 2 months or 2-3 months for a literature survey. That is how we give when we submit a research plan. We give 2-3 months for the literature survey. That is how we give.
Okay. Is this keeping in mind that we have to attend the college as well?
Yes. Because even when you are a researcher, okay. So you have to, suppose you have joined for, as a research scholar, if you have joined for a research work. So then also you have to attend coursework and all, right? You have to attend coursework. Seminar is a part of the coursework. So for that also you have to study. So parallelly only you are doing there also. It's not that you will only do literature survey throughout the day. So you have to plan accordingly so that every day some time you can devote to do this.
Okay, thank you.
Hello, good morning, ma'am.
Yes, okay, fine. Yes, please ask me.
Hello,
yes, you good can afternoon, ask ma'am. Question.
Hello?
Yes.
Yeah, good afternoon, ma'am.
Tell me.
Yeah. So, ma'am, is it possible at UG level we can propose a research paper?
What is that?
Means at UG level, I am a UG student and I have attended some symposiums about power electronics solution for EV infrastructures. So, there is a lot of hot topics in EV management and electrical vehicle. Power electronic solutions. So is it possible at UG level we can propose a paper?
Yes, you can. You can do it. And there are options for that also for UG level directly students like hackathons and all. You can propose the project. Other than that, suppose you want to propose a project to a funding agency. That's what you mean?
Yes, ma'am. Yeah, under any professor like that. Yeah.
So if the funding agency, if you are approaching with the help of a professor, if you are approaching a funding agency, okay, then a UG level project you can give. Why I'm telling this is, I'll tell an example of IEEE itself. IEEE, if you are a member of Industrial Application Society, okay, IAS, if you are a member of Industrial Application Society, they give a faculty student research grant. They even give, if suppose the number is limited, they give only very few. But suppose you are getting that, even students will get fees for 1 year. So that grants are also available. So with the help of a professor, you can always approach for UG level projects as well. Even IEI, Institution of Engineers India, they give money for, you have to be a member of IEI. It's like IEEE. You have to be a member of IEEE for approaching for project proposals. Similarly, IEA gives up to 1 lakh for projects for UG level. We have got in our college for undergraduate level, we have got money for project for undergraduate projects. So they give 70,000, up to 1 lakh they give, sometimes 50,000. They give. That is more than enough for a UG level project. Institution of Engineers India, IEEE, whatever I'm coming to my mind, I'm telling you. This you can search. You have student faculty grant projects under IEEE.
Yes, ma'am. I already IEEE student member from Central University of Karnataka.
You can search for that faculty student grant. You can approach the professor through him or her. You can apply for it.
Thank you, ma'am.
Good afternoon. There's a question, ma'am. Just a second. There's a question from Kritika Tripathi. It says, how to publish our research paper on internet?
I saw that. I was about to answer that. Yes. See, you cannot publish like that a research paper on internet. What you have to do, you have to publish in a conference or in a journal. So automatically, it will be appearing in the internet. When somebody searches your paper, it will come. So you have to join. There are n number of journals available. So you need to choose a good journal. if you want to publish a good paper and in a good journal, you need to identify a good journal. Actually, there is a list of approved UGC journals which you will get from the net. So that you can search, and there only you publish. Because there are n number of journals which is of similar name as that of UGC approved journals. It is available in the net. And they take very less money. So we tempt to publish there. That you should not do, according to me. So when you are publishing a paper, you should publish in a journal or a conference which is reputed. So what is the advantage you are getting? You will get good review comments so that you can improve your paper. And it will be, and for the institute also it is good, and for you also it is good when you go for higher studies. And for the institute it is good for NIRF ranking and for accreditation. For all that, it is good for the institute also if the journal is Scopus indexed or if it is UGC approved. So always choose a journal wisely. So that is my answer to Kritika. You cannot publish just like that. You have to go through a journal or through a conference or a book as a part of a book so that it is available in the net, internet.
Thank you so much, ma'am. This is Dr. Khadim Moin Siddiqui. Yes. And I have a question, ma'am. Ma'am, am I audible, ma'am?
Yes, sir. You please go ahead.
Okay. Ma'am, actually, we have seen here in our institution, or if we are discussing in some conference, then we have seen some undergraduate students come with a novel and solid idea. Okay, they come, sir, we want to do work in this side. So their idea is novel, but now they have to start their work. But actually, literature survey is required for that. Because they have to do literature survey, and after that they will come with their solid problem. So ma'am, how can we motivate to the undergraduate students to read the research paper and do the literature survey? Then ma'am, how can we motivate these bright students?
See, what motivate in the sense, how to tell them to read? That is what you mean,
yes,
right?
Yes, read the research paper, and if they will read again and again, then they will get some knowledge, and then they will implement that novel idea. So ma'am, how can we motivate and how can we encourage to read their research papers?
See, according to me, you know, if an undergraduate group comes, it will be better because they will come in a group. At least 2-3 students will come. So they can divide different parts of their, whatever they are suggesting, they can divide into different parts, and different students can search on different areas of the same topic. So that then they can discuss what are their findings and which literature, what was mentioned that way. And the first and foremost is they should search for the original paper relating to or somewhat relating to their idea. Original paper. So that will be a basic paper. And then they should see what are the references they have given, and then they should build on. So first of all, it is the basic paper. There the explanation will be very basic. Because later on, when we are referring to some original paper, we will not explain that well. We will only write in such a way that the reader knows that. So if we are building on some project. So that is why I'm saying it is always better. I tell my students like that to read the basic paper, original paper about that topic. So that will be a paper which will have a very high number of citations also. Because it is a basic paper, many will refer to that. It will have high number of citations. So that way you can see which is that paper. So then they can slowly build up, and they can divide and do also. So they will learn more in the process when they discuss after that.
Thank you so much.
You can also go for funding also.
Ma'am, there's a counter question from Kritika Tripathi. She says she participated through ACM, SEM, GPC, in which her research paper were among the top 13. So she's asking whether she'll be able to publish them all or not.
ACM, SEM, GPC, that can you tell me, Kritika?
That is, I think, ma'am, there will be any conference, I think. Because she is saying does not have microphone.
Oh, okay. So yeah. If it is a conference, they will publish it in generally, or all conference publishers publish it in the internet. It is available in the net actually. That is what I'm
It's on. Association for Computing Machinery, she says.
And what is this SCMGPC? Is it a conference?
Because no, ma'am, it's a chapter.
It is a chapter.
Yes.
Then she can go ahead and present in a paper, some conference. If it is a chapter which is in her institute or something, she can go ahead and publish it. That is not plagiarism. She can go ahead and publish in some other conference. That is not an issue.
Okay, thank you, ma'am.
Hello, ma'am.
Yes.
Hello.
Yes, yes, please go ahead.
As you shared a link of PESD, can you brief it? What is that?
One second, I'll just see. Where it is? What is your name? Can you just?
Shanur Rahman is in the chat box. There's a PESD 2021 link, registration link. What is that? Can you brief it, please?
Shanur, it's our upcoming event.
Okay. That is that institute, their institute's event. The institute which, who is organizing this, correct, no? Their
yes,
event.
Ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Kirti, now you can proceed.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. On behalf of IEEE BBD ITM students.
Sorry. Kirti, sorry to interrupt, ma'am. Kirti, sorry to interrupt, ma'am. I have a question. Can I ask? I know.
Yes, sure.
Ma'am, I had a quick question that what topics or what research? I mean, what area can you suggest for the first year of engineering students who are like literally starting from scratch? What can you suggest, any topic or any area which they can start on so they can help with their career?
First year of engineering, you are telling?
Yes, ma'am, for the juniors, like the first year and second year.
I feel it is better to start from second year if they don't have any background of any topic or anything. It is better because they will have a flavor of engineering in the first year. Okay, what is engineering all about? And when they come to engineering, most of them, they don't have an idea. Because many ask me, what is the difference between a scientist and an engineer and all. So that is why I'm telling, they don't have much idea about what is engineering when they come in first year. So first year, they will study 2 semesters when they spend. They will study what is engineering, what is it all about. Then second year onwards, they will have some flavor to some area and then they can start. Otherwise, if they are extraordinary students, they can start from the first year itself. And to start with, they can start with a survey paper. Survey papers are also accepted by publishers, even IEEE. IEEE accepts conferences. I'm not telling journal in the first year level. So you can have a survey paper based on the topic what they're studying in first year. Physics related or electrical subject is there, electrical or electronic subject related based on their interest. But I feel it is too early if it is an ordinary student. That's what I feel. This is my personal opinion. So second year onwards, they can think of doing some mini projects.
Yes, thank you so much, ma'am. Any student, if you are having any question, then you can raise. Please, you are welcome.
Hello, ma'am. Hello.
I guess she got disconnected.
No, actually, ma'am had joined from, I think, mobile. So we can wait for 1 minute.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, in between there was some connection problem. Yeah.
Yes, ma'am. There is a question from you, ma'am.
Yeah.
Ma'am, as you mentioned that quality of the goods researcher,
yeah.
You had also mentioned the researcher researcher would be religious.
Yeah,
then,
yeah.
Ma'am, I want to ask to you that what is the necessary of the religion to being a good researcher?
I will tell you. I also thought about that when I first saw that. See, we should have always have a positivity in us. Okay, so that something good happen when you start a research. The research is basically a trial and error. So we should have an optimism in us that something good will happen. That is what it is. The religious means.
Can an atheist would be a good researcher?
What is that?
Ma'am, any atheist person would be a good researcher?
No. I am not telling a belief of God and all. I am only telling that we should have a positivity in us. Means we should have a belief that good things will happen in our research. Or everything will turn out good at the end. That belief we should have. That is what I mean religious. And they also must have meant that only. Okay.
Thank you, ma'am. Kirti, now you can continue.
Hello.
Yes.
Okay. So now on behalf of IEEE BBD ITM student branch, am I audible?
Yes.
Okay. On behalf of IEEE BBD ITM student branch, I, Kirti Agarwal, wants to thank Dr. Mini Raji for her insightful presentation today on research paper, project proposal submission, and paper writing. We are grateful for the time and effort you took to share your thoughts and experiences with us students here. I believe we can benefit immediately from the tips and tricks you suggested for our writings. Your enthusiasm is contagious, and we hope to use your suggestions in our future works. Thank you again for making this webinar a success, and we appreciate your continued support. Next, I invite Professor Kanika Lamba for a vote of thanks.
Thank you so much, Kirti. Good afternoon, everyone. It's my privilege to present vote of thanks on this occasion. On behalf of entire team of Babu Banarsidas Institute of Technology and Management, I would like to thank our honorable speaker for this enthralling session. I am sure that each individual who attended this session will go back with a lot of thoughts and will prove to be a source of motivation for the time to come. A special thanks to our honorable chief guest, Ma'am Dr. Mini Raji, who is truly a source of inspiration and a role model for all the young engineers present here. Her knowledge and experience shared will indeed prove to be a pathway for our engineers. This is the time our fourth year students are writing their research paper. And ma'am, your lecture will definitely prove beneficial for our students. Students, by writing research paper, your name is highlighted. This has a huge impact on your resume. You will easily be able to impress a multinational organization and get recruited. Or even if you want to continue with your master's and doctorate, this session will surely prove will be helpful for you. Secondly, I feel proud to mention, ma'am, your timeless effort in WI growth and upliftment. Ma'am, we do expect your guidance for WI growth in BBD ITM in coming future. Thank you so much, ma'am, wholeheartedly. I take this special opportunity to say a heartfelt thanks to our Honorable Director, Sir and Dr. Bhavesh Kumar Chauhan, who lent his shoulder to IEEE development, due to which IEEE is here today, and also for his timely guidance and giving us rich insights. I also want to thank our respected HOD, EE and EN department, Professor Rafiq Ahmed, for his mentorship and for about IEEE structure and genesis of IEEE establishment in BBT ITM. I also want to extend my thanks to Dr. Khadim Moin Siddiqui, who is IEEE advisor for Signal Processing Society, for his consistent support and efforts. Sir, you always prove to be a source of inspiration for us. Thank you so much, sir. My heartfelt thanks goes to our anchor for the day, Prince Verma and Kirti Agarwal. Our technical team working behind Shrey Khanna and Shrikant Singh. Our Signal Processing Society chair, Shambhavi. Our IEEE volunteers who always work day and night and making BBT ITM names highlighted not only in UP section, but also in Region 10 level. Thank you so much, students. You people are really a strong team and we're really lucky enough to have you along with us. Thank you so much, students. Lastly, I thank all the volunteers who are present here to make this session a grand success. Thank you so much wholeheartedly. Over to you, Kirti.
Thank you, ma'am. IEEE has been organizing different events time to time. On the upcoming PES Day, on the 18th of April, IEEE BBD ITM branch is throwing an inaugural session on the PES Day celebration. I, on behalf of IEEE student branch, seek your presence and support for the event then. Do register yourself beforehand. Registration form link has been provided in the chat box section. Attendees are also requested to fill up the feedback form. Link is provided in the chat box session. Yeah. Now I officially announce the
Moin, Professor Kaniga Lamba, then Shrey Khanna, who was coordinating with me, and the anchors, Prince Verma and Kirti Agarwal. Thank you so much. And thanks to all the participants.
Thank you, ma'am.